There is a dark room under the quiet corridors of Pripyat's abandoned hospital. A room that was never meant to exist and probably never meant to be entered again. This is where the radioactive clothes of the first Chernobyl responders remain to this day. Yet some still choose to go down there, not realizing they make a horrible mistake. This is its story. But some unfortunately have to go there. This footage was taken by a zone specialist performing a required inspection. The kind of inspection that actually shouldn't have been necessary at all, if this place had remained undisturbed by adventure seekers. And although it was filmed a few years ago, the current radiation levels here have not changed significantly. So what is this place and what happened here? Officially, the Pripyat Medical Complex was a structural department of Chernobyl nuclear power plant. It was called the Medical Sanitary Unit number 126. Behind that name is a huge compound of 10 buildings occupying a notable part of Pripyat, and it was designed to handle 600 visits a day. Well, such scale was completely justified, because the power plant was developing rapidly and so did its city. And although this building is now in a very poor condition, much of the equipment and many items still remain inside. That gives a glimpse of how large scale and well organized everything once was here. But these walls witness something for which this place was never prepared. During the night and early morning of April 26, 1986, ambulances kept arriving at its doors. Among those brought here were commanders of two fire brigades, Vladimir Pravik and Viktor Kibinok, and their colleagues, Vladimir Tishura, Mikola Titanok, Vasily Gnatenko, Mikola Vashuk, and many others. Also brought in were power plant workers, operators Oleksandr Akimov and Leonid Toptunov, engineer Vladimir Shashinok, and many, many more. As many of you know, we have many friends who used to live in Pripyat. And according to their recollections, there were so many ambulances that they almost completely filled the entire parking lot of the hospital. And some of the victims had already received several fatal doses of radiation. Many were still standing on their feet and by memories, even trying to joke, but the days of their lives unfortunately were already numbered. In that moment, however, few realized what actually happened, and those who did refused to believe it. You see, that is what human mind does when something is happening too suddenly, too fast. It all was just developing far too fast to comprehend. And still, the first thing that was done was to remove their contaminated clothes, and it had to be disposed of quickly. The problem was that the hospital had nowhere to put such things. And so someone just decided to take these clothes down to the basement, which is full of various technical and storage rooms. And it was dumped in a pile in one of them. This historical episode is roughly depicted in HBO's Chernobyl miniseries, when nurses suffer better burns on their skin after contact with these items. Well, in reality, such injuries do not appear immediately, but otherwise the depiction is quite close to the truth. However, among those items, there is none belonging to the engineer-mechanic Vladimir Shashinok. It is known that he has suffered a broken spine and passed away from severe injuries early that very morning. It happened just a few hours after being brought to the Pripyat medical unit. And shortly he was buried in the cemetery of the village of Chistohalivka. It's just a few kilometers from Pripyat. There are two very good documentary movies by Roland Sergienko, For Whom the Bell Tolls and The Bell Tolls for You. So there are scenes showing the exhumation of his body in November 1988. I must say, the ending of the scene is rather graphic, so we better suggest you watching the full version in the films on your own. So, when they open the coffin, it's visible that Shashanok is still dressed in the decayed white uniform of a Chernobyl nuclear power plant worker. The reason for this operation was that the authorities in Moscow decided to rebury him in a local Mitina cemetery, alongside with other first responders who perished. Well, for majority of them, this was very far from their homeland. After the evacuation of Pripyat, the city's medical unit continued to operate for some short time to serve the needs of the exclusion zone. And understandably, there were far more pressing concerns then, so the staff just avoided going down into the basement. Later, when the medical unit was relocated to the city of Chernobyl, its contents were simply forgotten for decades. Years after, in the mid-2000s, the conditions of the buildings in Pripyat were still enough good, and actually there were no restrictions on exploration. And at that time, someone accidentally discovered this room. I remember the time very well. There was no this frivolous Chernobyl tourism yet, and only serious people came here. The vast majority of them believed others would share their sense of responsibility towards the city. So, from the best considerations, that person published their discovery online. But as it turned out, that was a big mistake. Random people began visiting the basement, and some were motivated by desire to witness a piece of history, others to see the high radiation levels. But some came to take things out. This photo I took myself, I think, in 2011, I don't remember well already. A bit later, someone pulled out part of the helmet liner and placed it on a table near the entrance. Then, unfortunately, it only escalated. The shoes and coveralls used by people to enter that basement were often just thrown out right on the first floor. In other words, what once wasn't heavily contaminated now is, and it's no longer possible to localize that contamination. You know, in a decade and a half working in the Chernobyl zone, I still cannot understand these people's motivation. Because if it was an attempt to get a dose of adrenaline rush, well, the only thing they really got was a dose of radiation. See, sometimes I hear people say that the levels in the basement, though they're high, aren't enough to cause any serious harm. Well, if you look at levels alone, then yes, it is rather true. But here is the catch, there is more. Let me share the opinion of our colleagues who professionally handle much more dangerous radioactive waste at Chernobyl repositories. In short, those who think that nothing will happen after a trip to the basement are very, very wrong. This is because the firefighters arrived at the plant at the very beginning of the catastrophe. At that moment, the most intense release was occurring, and basically their clothing was literally saturated with the fine radioactive dust. Of course, that dust spread throughout all the zone, but here it is in a very, very particular state. Because isotopes, first and foremost, are chemical elements, and outside they dissolve, filtered, washed away by rain and snow, bound by plants and surfaces. But here, in this basement, none of that happens. The basement is basically some sort of grotesque time capsule. Down there, it is still an eternal 1986. What was released from the reactor at that time is now very well known. Some isotopes, however, like cerium-144, have since decayed, but most remain active. And if you descend here with a spectrometer, that's a device that can identify isotopes, you make some discoveries. You will find not only cesium and strontium, but also plutonium, uranium, americium, and even the zone's rare europium. But that still is only half of the problem. There are also the so-called hot particles, microscopic fragments of nuclear fuel with very high activity. And many of them emit exclusively alpha particles, which cannot be detected by a regular dosimeter, That often gives a false sense of safety. However, inhaling alpha particles is extremely dangerous, because inside the body nothing can stop them, and eventually the body's tissues are completely unprotected. You can only go down there wearing a sealed disposable suit and an isolating gas mask. But ideally, you shouldn't go at all. In 2016, the problem of illegal visas became so serious that the Zone administration decided to act rather radically. And so they just dumped several tons of sand into the basement entrance, sealing it, well, at least in theory. Unfortunately, it wasn't entirely effective, because the basement is very large, and so some alternative paths still remained. The hospital building is made of red brick, and naturally, that material is among the first to crumble. So I guess in the foreseeable future, the problem will resolve itself naturally. And perhaps that is how it should end. Because despite all efforts to bring the bodies of the first liquidators back home, they still rest in another country. So maybe symbolically and ethically, it is right that the place of their suffering and their hope for rescue should finally be left undisturbed. Do not forget to subscribe so you won't miss our new episodes. Bonus materials for this one, such as the rare images of the hospital's construction we recently scanned from original films, you can find on our Patreon page. The link is in the description below. Thank you for watching, and we'll see you in the next episode of Chernobyl Uncharted.